Welcome.
So, welcome to part two of Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, and it's the barroom brawl sequence, once in a vial, 1M6A. So last week, I saw you, we were looking at the very first bit of this once in a vial thing. Absolutely extraordinary, huge amounts of Hungarian minor mixed in with octatonicism, 3-3 used as a bridging chord, not necessarily lots of filigree at this one, lots of little short longs, lots of planing in terms of this sort of Jaws-esque thing, a couple of different ostinatos, which are all octatonically derived, and definitely octatonically derived, and then a mad sequence, a typical sort of Williams sequence of ridiculous gnarly chords which all seem to sort of combine in one. One thing I didn't mention actually last week is look at the top notes. They're all going up. Like that. but they're not doing it obviously by just going, which is the sort of thing you might get in 1980s Doctor Who, which is sort of crass and probably written really quickly, where you get this like that. It's much more sort of oblique and unexpected, and each one of them is block chordally harmonised as well, against a sort of wrong bass, because this doesn't really suggest it's going to go to F. Being the dominant B flat, so it's sort of rather mad almost. Then we've got the Cole Porter, so orchestrated by Courage, Alexander Courage, And that is the dance orchestra bit. So we've got this going on. Absolutely brilliant, isn't it? It's so good. And this is written on a separate score, and then interspersed. So then when you've got it all going on, because we've got the dance orchestra here, I know it's difficult to see, I'll try and make it a little bit bigger. So this is what we've got. I didn't put the drums in. Interesting bit here actually. On the piano it makes it really obvious because the trombones are at the same pitch as everybody else. So it's very, very difficult to distinguish on a piano. But of course the timbral difference means that it can easily be differentiated in the dance orchestra. And that's when the trombones take over. Really incredibly good writing. So it comes in here. There's a little bit where it gets slightly lost here, but that's sort of really, really quibbling. And I don't think you could argue that there's anything other than 100% perfect orchestrationally. So then let's work out what else is going on. So we've got strings going on. Oh, a little ostinato. Like that. Short longs, which is from what we had before. So we've got the dance orchestra, Cole Porter. So basically, everything is supporting that tune. It's everything else is sort of little accompaniment, scampering little sort of mousy type accompaniment, sort of Scott Bradley-esque. Interesting that there's nothing else in the way of sort of wind at that point. We've just got that little violin line going on. So then we've got this sort of lovely bit going on here. So one thing that's interesting is to think about sort of how things are voiced. And I'll, in a way, it doesn't really need me to explain it. It's just one of those things where you just have to go through all of it and work out what's going on. So often the top note in block chordal harmonization will have the same top note as the harmony. So the harmony, which is in six parts, but we've got doubled up notes. So the F is already doubled up by all of the saxes. The D is not doubled at all anywhere else. The B flat is, and the F is, and the G is not. So we don't have doubled third, and we don't have doubled that six. It's B flat six. So it's a really good example of how how to do a four note chord, but between six different things. So you can see that the root's doubled and the fifth is doubled, but the six and the third isn't. So interesting, and those are often those are the sort of the target notes as well. So they're the ones that are not doubled. Then the same chord, then because that moves to a G, it just moves upwards to the next nearest possible inversion. Like that, and when it moves down to D, it moves down by one note, not too low, because otherwise it just sounds not great. So that usually sort of having a third kind of danger there. maybe B flat and D is perhaps the lowest. So notice also all of these sort of little things here. There's nothing else happening at there where the cellos and the double basses are. This little scampering bit as well, there's nothing happening in the accompaniment at that point. So contrapuntally it's good. Also off beats, ba, like that, to emphasize. And that lovely sort of chord, which is just going up in triads, really, in second version, with a fifth in the bass, but then not here. Like that. So it changes slightly because of that chord here, which is a D major chord over E flat. And it seems to work quite nicely. Again, I'm not a jazzer, so jazzers could explain why a D major chord over E flat works perfectly well. Going to another sort of modulatory passage here, where we got the melody just staying on C, but we got all sorts of other things going on. It's lots of oscillation. F7, really extraordinary. Sounds like George Gershwin at that point. And it's all sort of chromatic movement. You know, I like the fact that we've got stability there, but then these notes are going outwards. You know, if they went outwards, they could go outwards again. Like that. Again, it's similar to what we had right at the beginning. Like that. Back here. I've realised that I think it's page down makes you, or home and end makes you go through pages really quickly in spades, which is very useful. Yeah. I mean, really extraordinary. So, lots of second inversions. And then here, everything seems to work quite nicely with the dance orchestra and the rest of the orchestra. An F dominant going to B flat, so F dominant here and F dominant here. And then some absolute complete madness. So after those sort of extraordinary two bars, we've got a sort of tonic. Let's call it a B flat 6 if we want to. But then we've got a Mixolydian E major against the B flat. Real sort of Scott Bradley type of thing to do at that point. So really interesting. So then we've got all sorts of five ofs. So we'll see it in action here. When it goes into F. So it's just 5 of G, 5 of F, 5 of A, 5 of G. Like that. And then with scampering bits at the top. And then that's just... sort of re-emphasizing what's going on. These are just picking out chord tones. Of sevenths. And then eventually, that's interesting, the seventh with that. So there's always something that he does which is sort of unusual. I'm not sure to what extent this was orchestrated by Williams or Courage at this point, but I would imagine Williams probably, because he is a jazzer, but then maybe Courage is as well. So then we've got sort of, you know, a really good example of block chordal harmonization, like a sort of Berkeley jazz course, circa 1960. In fact, Stephen Sondheim would be proud of this, with Jonathan Tunick, like that. And it's just all harmonizing the tune. But notice what's going on here. All sorts of different things. So it's supposed to be F major. If I play it all together as a piano, absolutely sort of awful. Then we got these fourths, which is sort of, you know, they're in Hong Kong, sort of crass sort of cultural thing going on there. So anyway, then we've got sort of more chromatic passing notes, but with sort of chromatic descending bass, like that, which is another sort of jazz device as well. But it works absolutely brilliantly against the trombone tune. Thing goes, and then we're back in F. With a completely wrong sort of scale. So we got an F sharp mixer leading at this point. Don't know why I didn't put it in. I haven't been very well. Let's use that as an excuse. Over F. There we go. Oh, interesting. I changed that to blue and it should be red. So yeah, crazy. So then we've got this sort of other little passage which becomes more important later. So lots and lots of E's going on. We've got that sort of pedal and sort of little stabs going out. Like that in terms of the tune, but everything is sort of now sort of drawing to a close, where we've got this little passage again. And then we've got these two bars of sheer absolute madness. So what is going on here? So we get to D9. Then we've got F major 9 with a flat 5. So let's look at the voicing of this. So we got that. So it's not quite going down by a semitone. So actually it oscillates there. And I think it coincides with this. So here the horns are just doing exactly what the saxophones are doing. But look at the upper extensions of the violins. They're doing something else. So so it's like a sort of, you know, the 2-5-1 type of situation. So the C sharp is just adding another extension to that. So it's just an oscillation. So actually this is just an auxiliary chord completely. It's just semitone below, basically, with more extension. So then we've got with added spice, same sort of thing, actually, same chord, in fact. So actually, interestingly enough, that's not quite right there in the context of the D major at the top. With a sharp 4, so sharp 11 type sort of 13 chord as well. So sharp 11, 13, and a C7. And then we've got D7 flat 5. So flat, then augmented. Yeah, so when it all fits together. So, we got the trumpets doing the tune. In their sort of, yes, let's not comment too much upon that. And in amongst all of this sort of absolute nonsense. So the bass line. Dum bum ba dum bum. So it cuts out completely there. You would have thought it would carry on, but now there's a 3-3 to help that get over it. So, yeah, so we've got all of this sort of tune coming back, end of the dance orchestra at bar 67. So really, really extraordinary. Then we're back into the familiar territory, really. Pardon me, I shouldn't talk for so long. Like that, sort of C major 7. And then we got some really extraordinary chords. So all subsets of Hungarian minor. Then we got this going on. So really extraordinary at that point. All little injections. So all subsets of Hungarian minor. All of these ones. Then G sharp Hungarian minor, except for the F natural. And then we're back into our little 0134 ostinato set. That's an octatonic. Typical sort of trumpet fanfare, this time augmented chords in root position, then minor, then followed by minor. Like that. A little bit of filigree, basically a G minor harmonic with an added F natural. But with an F natural in there. So just using a minor scale. Then harmonized in fourths, augmented fourths. So then more octatonic sets. Then the same thing again, just going up. That just related to that. So instead of starting on B flat, starts on C. and ends up a semitone higher. Then an actual octatonic scale, which is really unusual, actually. There's no other ones in this bit. There we go. And then cuts out just before the... There's no final note. Da-ga-da-ga-da. It's just da-ga-da-ga-da. It just sort of leaves off the first beat. Then we got some more sort of 016s, this time sort of a slightly different version of the 013. Like that. So then more 0134s. just climbs chromatically. Then we got F sharp minor. Pardon me. And then we've got this sort of now B flat octatonic thing going on. Pardon me. With more 0-1-3-4. Against the anything goes. And it's a diametric opposite, as a sort of augmented fourth. And all across the bar line as well. Lots of 3/3s in attendance because it's all octatonic. Then, so unusually skipping out a note there. I would have probably just gone like that and just done a full octatonic, but he doesn't. Like that, I think, just to sort of make sure it's in seven beats in that sort of seven divisions rather of that sort of two quavers. Then we've got more of the anything goes with a slightly wider interval at this point. And then combines all of the material that we've had before. So this, that sort of idea, it's just the same as digga 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 dubba. Then 522, another subset of Hungarian minor, so that comes back. So then it's this sort of extraordinary bit here where we got sort of lots of 419s. So C augmented with a major seventh. Whoops. G half diminished. Like that. Then D flat with a major seventh and sharp five. Or 419 again. Then another D sharp half diminished. And it's really remarkable. Everything else is just filigree over the top of it. These just provide upper extensions to whatever this is. So they're part of the same harmonic scheme. but don't necessarily play all of the notes. Sometimes they coincide. This is the B flat minor bit, but of course it's above G. So the G gives it its sort of half diminished character. Otherwise it wouldn't be one. And then another half diminished. And then a wonderful divergent progression, which is the one that starts in the middle and then sort of goes outwards. So we've got descending bass. Completely chromatic. And then here we've got sort of augmented intervals, minor intervals, minor intervals, minor intervals, then major intervals, then augmented, and then major. Like that. B7 with a sharp 4 over E sharp. And then E with a major 7th, which is just incredible. So on the orchestra version of that, really extraordinary. That last sort of few bars is really extraordinary. It's where it goes into really high bits on the violins. I love that bit of the trumpet. It's just so Bolton-esque. Look at the voicing of that. That's just magnificent. With that as well, with the trawns. Brilliant. So, look, lots of space between that and here. That's the next highest note. So it's lots of middling notes, nothing else, because it's all filled up in here. It's got sort of quite polarized at that point. Sort of interesting there. I don't think there's anything other lower than that. Nope, there's no sort of there's nothing in that area. So from F to there, that's a sort of a tenth really. We have no other instruments. Really lovely sort of open sound. Really, really interesting. Very sort of classic Hollywood. Really interesting. Let's just listen to that again because it's so good. Yeah, and we got our Alexander Courage ludicrous sort of harp going on, known for his work on Star Trek, of course. It's truly magnificent, isn't it? I mean, what an extraordinary feat of composition in an action music cue. That you could probably study that for a month, going through it in fine detail, and still not really scratch the surface. So that's our aim, is to get as good as we can. The only other place you'll find it really at the moment is things like the Orville, where that sort of type of sound is demanded. So anyway, I hope you've enjoyed it. I mean, it's one of those cues which you can just probably, you know, it's a bit mind-blowing to begin with, but just try and break it down into small chunks. Again, always, what's melody, what's harmony, what's the bass line? And sometimes it's a little bit more complicated than that, but essentially, if you always stick to those three things and kind of work out what's going on. where it gets ridiculous is when he's got the dance orchestra and the orchestra at the same time, and that really is absolutely extraordinary. The superimposition of two different types of style at the same time is just magnificent. So that's it, folks. We will be venturing into Empire Strikes Back very soon, which I'm really excited about, and I'm going to be talking to Xanthi Tan from the Star Wars 5 Music Minutes at some point in, I think, October or November. I can't quite remember which, sorry. But I'm excited about that, so watch out for that. And look forward to hearing all of your thoughts about this. So, yeah, thank you very much. Bye.